To take apart your TRS-80 Model 3 or Model 4 computer, first you remove this one screw in the middle of the back, which if yours has been opened before may not even be there because it's easy to forget putting it back in. Then you turn it around and swing it back up on its back here. And then you can see all the rest of the screws you need to remove. There's three right under the keyboard there. There's two more over here in the middle of the keyboard. One over here, one over here, two more on the bottom, and finally one underneath the warranty sticker, which if yours is like mine and has never been opened before, you'll need to punch through this sticker to get to the screw.
All right, let's go to the videotape.
I actually have to break that warranty seal to get the case open. There's a screw hiding under there. So this computer has never been opened before, at least not by a non-Radio Shack technician. Okay. Supposed to look through here to make sure the neck of the picture tube is not snagging on anything. Okay, looks like I'm good. So there is the TRS-80 Model 4D with the cover removed. Obviously, the CRT comes out with the cover, so you have to be careful when pulling the case up because the neck of the CRT can catch on some of these things back here. This one is pretty well zip-tied back, so that's not so much of a problem. But if somebody removed this board and then didn't put these zip ties back in to secure the wires out of the way, there is a potential for this to catch on the wires, and some unlucky people have had the neck of the CRT break off when they're pulling it up. The trick is, as you pull up the cover, a gap opens up above the top of the top floppy drive and the opening here, which you can look through to see the neck of the CRT as you're pulling it up to make sure you're not going to run into anything back there. And one other thing you may notice is the lack of shielding. Now, Radio Shack did not intend for regular users to open up their Model 4. This is only supposed to be for certified service technicians, so they didn't feel the need to put any shielding in. So there's no shielding around the power supply and no shielding around the CRT. So if you're gonna run one of these with the cover open, you have to be careful where you put your fingers. And here are those half-height drives with a full-height faceplate. The drives are made by TEC, not to be confused with TEAC, Teak, the company that made the drives that Tandy used in their 1000 series computers. But these are TEC drives, model FB503. And yes, these are the same exact connectors that you would find on a 5 1/4 inch floppy drive in a PC. So if one of these would ever fail and you can't find an exact replacement, you can substitute a PC floppy drive. It has to, of course, be a double density 360K drive. You cannot use a 1.2 megabyte drive. Tandy, on both this computer and on their 1000 series, does not use the twist in the cable. So the first drive is drive select 0, and the second drive is drive select 1. And maybe you can see back there, that one, the jumper is on the first position, so that's drive select 0. And this one is on the second position, so that's drive select 1. That's the way you set up these floppy drives, in case you're retrofitting a double-sided drive in an older Model 4 that only has single-sided drives, you can do that too. The operating system doesn't care. Whenever you go to format a disk, it asks you if it's single or double-sided, so the operating system doesn't mind what kind of drives you use. So you can take an older Model 4 and put in double-sided drives and it'll work just fine. And here's a closer look at the power supply. All the capacitors look fine. So, unlike a lot of more modern PC power supplies, when you see bulging capacitors that are obviously on the verge of failure if they haven't failed already, these look perfectly fine. The power supply is an Aztec, rated at 50 watts maximum output, 65 watts for forced air, but this is not forced air, there's no fan, so 50 watts output on the power supply. And the picture tube is a Philips 12VCM P31. I believe the P31 is what type of phosphor it uses, the code for the green phosphor it uses. There's the little circuit board on the neck there, and the high voltage lead. And there's the board with the flyback and all the trimmers to adjust the CRT. And if you want to completely disconnect the case with the CRT from the rest of the computer, you just carefully unplug that, and then ground wire comes off either side. Come on. There we go. So now this is free from the rest of the computer. And there are some production dates. June 26th and July 10th, 1985. So that was right around when Radio Shack first introduced the Model 4D. So just like the serial number says, this is a very early Model 4D. So we have a keyboard, disk drives, power supply, big empty space where the CRT goes when the cover is closed. And the whole computer is in this metal cage back here. So obviously some further disassembly is needed to actually see the components in there. You also notice there is no fan in this computer or in any of the Model 3s or Model 4s. Instead, cool air gets sucked up by convection from these vents on the bottom, and as heat rises, it goes out the vents on the top. And this thing barely even gets warm. I've had it on for well over an hour, and it's just barely warm to the touch on those vents up there, right, even right above the CRT. So it's a very cool running computer. A few screws later and the shield comes off the back of the motherboard, and there it is. You can see the little beeper that the Model 4 has. The Model 3 did not have this, but this was added to give it at least some internal sound capabilities, although most software did not actually use this. Here's the 64K RAM and the blank sockets where you can add another 64K to upgrade it to 128K. This one has had some rework done around here. Another jumper wire there. So clearly there were some mistakes in the circuit board that they probably had a later revision to fix. All the way in the corner here is the Z80A CPU. Right next to it, the keyboard cable, which goes all the way down to the front of the case. There, here's the floppy drive cable. Here's the cassette port cable with the relay to turn the cassette motor on and off. And you can see the card edges for the various expansion ports. This one is the external floppy. This is the serial port right down here, you can see it. That's the expansion bus, and that's the printer port. With the little ferrite bead filters on all of its pins to help keep the signals clean. So that really is pretty much it. And the only tool I've needed to tear this whole thing apart, just an ordinary Phillips screwdriver. I'm just gonna give this thing a good cleaning. I may swap the two floppy drives because it seems like this one is a little more noisy than this one, because obviously this one would have more use. So I may swap them to help equalize the wear. But otherwise, all it needs is just a little cleaning to clean out some of this dust. But that's about it. Well, I thought I would need to remove this power supply to get to the fourth screw holding the floppy drives in, because it's blocking them. But if I just swing this out of the way, you can see Tandy never put in that screw to begin with. So they were smart. They did it that way so you don't need to remove the power supply to remove the floppy drives. There is the upper floppy drive removed. Stepper motor, also made by TEC, Tokyo Electric Company. I'm going to clean these heads in here. It has the timing circles. So, the two floppy drives have been swapped and cleaned, and I also cleaned the edge of the keyboard bezel to remove the dust that built up in the gap between the case and the bezel. So the keys themselves still need a better cleaning, but at least the bezel is nice and clean now. And there it is with the cover put back on, but before I put all the screws back in, I just want to turn it on and make sure it still works. All right, that's a good sign. Okay, both drives work.